r/AskReddit, what's the biggest culture shock you ever experienced? I grew up in a relatively poor neighborhood. Lot of rough shit going on there, but we won't discuss all of it. Suffice it to say, even at a fairly young age I was pretty sure I'd seen some shit. In middle school I made friends with a kid that lived in the trailer park across town. The trailer park kids are a whole different type of poor. I remember the kid I was friends with, as soon as I got there goes, "Let's go to the creek." Darius got his fishing pole back. Okay, whatever the hell that means. So we go down to the creek and there's this kid Darius, and he's fishing in a creek and there's about 12 kids standing around watching him. Every so often he's catching a fish and handing it to one of the kids, and the kid is taking the fish and running off giddy as hell. He finally catches one and hands it to my friend. He and I skip off back to his trailer. My friend takes the fish, as is, puts it in the microwave, and then when the microwave beeps he takes it out and starts eating it with a fork. I almost puked. That's kind of sweet. Darius giving each of the kids a fish to eat. I agree. Actually, Darius has a lot in common with Jesus Christ. Damn. Had a friend who lived in a trailer park for a while, but it wasn't that bad. Didn't even gut his first. Bonus. The park was right next to the only two strip clubs in town. Yep, my mom had a short commute. 2. When a large Maori man asked to touch noses with me in greeting. The dude looked pissed until I manned up and was the first to touch noses. Then he had one of the best smiles I've ever seen on a mountain of a man. It lit up the entire cultural center. This happened to me in the bathroom of a pub my second night in Auckland. Dude looked like straight out of Once Were Warriors. Dude pulled me in real strong, held my head to his, and then said, "Welcome to Aotearoa, I loved living in NZ. Best 3 years of my life." Wife and went to NZ for a honeymoon from the US in 1999. As soon as we got back I started looking into emigration. But the wife didn't want to leave her family. I loved my time there. Weirdly enough, it was returning to America after spending years abroad in Albania. As mentioned elsewhere in this thread, Albania didn't have any international food chains or restaurants. Everything was local and, usually, tasted great. I think what it was for me, was when I was going to Albania, I psyched myself up. I knew I was going to a foreign country and that things would be different. And they were. Most stores were no bigger than the size of my bedroom back home. Open-air street markets were common and roadside shops were everywhere. Most people didn't own vehicles and walked or relied on public transportation. But when I returned to America, I was just going home and didn't really think about it much. But after several years it was weird. The day after returning home, we went to a Costco. Walking around that place on that day was one of the most surreal experiences of my life. Packages of food were huge and there was just so much of everything. We drove our cars everywhere and I realized my little hometown doesn't even have a proper bus system. That was easily my biggest culture shock, and it was about my own. Reverse culture shock is a thing. I moved to Poland in 1989, as communism was failing. For 6 months, Coke was sold on one side of the city, and Pepsi had the other side. 95% of the cars were two models. All painted in the exact same colors for the past 40 years. None of the buildings were painted. You could get anywhere on public transportation for almost free. Bus ticket was $0.0001 each. Not one McDonald's or franchise store in the whole country. Almost every basic commodity like soap, cheese, there was only one choice. I literally felt like I had entered the Twilight Zone. Best trip ever. Watching children in Mexico happily eating crickets like they were popcorn also. 4 or 5 year old kids out at 10 p.m. to sell gum. They also sell cigarettes. WHO thinks insects can be a major source of solving worldwide hunger crises. It makes sense, to be fair. They have no bones. Need little prep. Apparently roasting locusts and adding honey is amazing. And spawn breed based on degree days. So they grow quickly. A lot. And potentially year-round. I had a French friend who told me chocolate-covered ants are a tasty treat. I was never sure how serious they were. It took me a few moments to realize you are talking about the World Health Organization and not just angrily asking people if they agree with you. Holidaying in Tokyo and watching 5-year-old kids walk themselves home from school and catching public transport, all by themselves. I taught in Japan. My first week there, a kid fell asleep on the train and some random old lady buttoned up his jacket and tucked his bag under his arm. Makes you wonder what is different socially about Japan that allows them to have these interactions. Going to the USA and seeing that the water in the toilets is so full. How the duck am I meant to shit without getting my ass wet? Also, NYC taxis will blare their horns at ducking anything. Pedestrians still on the crossing 2 seconds after the light goes green. Honk. Car in front of you gently brakes. Honk. Bird in the road. Honk. Bee in the car. Honk. The street lights turn on. Honk. They're super aggressive drivers. Mine was the opposite. Turkish toilets. There's very little water and a slide where your poop hits and travels down into the water. WTF. Poop stains in every toilet. All the Americans just made a sled of toilet paper for your poo to ride on its way into the small pool of water at the bottom. So I'm Norwegian, but I went to New Zealand for a year. The culture shock for me was how open Kiwis talk, and how there's no such thing as stranger danger. And as a typical Norwegian introvert, it took a while to get used to. I'd meet a stranger and they'd be breaking the touching barrier right away and start talking about their cousin's rash and all their weekend plans. Even bigger shock returning to silent Norway. I was lost in Oslo looking for a certain address and my phone wasn't working right. I did what most Americans would do is and stopped the next person I saw and asked if they could point me in the right direction. Well, the first guy I asked was an Afghan refugee who actually spoke okay amounts of English. He was so excited that I wanted to talk to him that he personally walked me to my direction and was going on and on how no one wants to talk to him, both because culturally you don't talk to strangers and because a lot of people don't like immigrants like himself. Coming from Los Angeles, where probably every other person you pass is an immigrant from somewhere, I found it totally puzzling. I'm Norwegian. And every time I ask a refugee immigrant about some non-consequential thing, like where the closest 7/11 is, we get talking about all sorts of things. With a Norwegian person, this would be horror. You and I don't know each other. This isn't right. I have enough friends. But with a person from another country, it's great. Cause I know I probably won't meet them again. They just want to talk. I ended up talking with a Turkish guy on the same bus for 3 months pretty much daily, and it got to be a real high point of the day. He had his family moved over here, and he was working 2 jobs supporting them, and buying properties back home. He was doing a sort of BNB thing. In a ho, he never asked my name, and I never asked his. It was just something to do on the bus while we were getting somewhere. This is highly unusual from Norwegian to Norwegian. I think it's not that we're racist or distrusting of others. It's just that you mind yours and I'll mind mine kind of attitude. It's kind of sad, but great when you just want to be left alone on the bus or at the coffee shop with your music, podcast, whatever. When I was a kid, one of my mother's friends was a woman from a very tough background who had left her husband because he used to hit her and her children. She had 3 kids and was living in a 2-bedroom council flat in a tough part of Glasgow. My mum met her because they were both doing part-time university degrees as mature students. She was studying to get a teaching qualification. I became friends with one of this woman's kids when I was about 6 or 7. I'd go over to his house for the night sometimes and we'd generally wander around the local neighborhood just doing what kids do. He always carried a rucksack and was always on the lookout for empty glass soda alcohol bottles. If he saw one, he'd grab it and stick it in the rucksack. After a while, I started bringing a rucksack along when I visited so we could double up on glass bottle carrying capacity. The reason he did this was that, in Glasgow back then, a sort of proto-recycling scheme meant that every one of those bottles was redeemable for 5p at any shop that sold them. They'd collect them, give out 5p per bottle, send them off to be recycled, and be reimbursed for their time by the local government. We'd collect a bunch of these then. When we went back to the flat in the afternoon, my friend would proudly hand over a few quid in coins to his mother. He used to do this constantly and it meant, this being the 1980s, a decent little earner to help pay for a bit of the household expenses and so on. I came from a family with a detached house in the suburbs that had 2 cars, 2 parents, 2 nice holidays a year, and no real worries when it came to money. Not rich, just lucky to be standard middle class. Meanwhile, this woman was raising three children by herself while studying to become a teacher in a tiny little damp flat in a bad part of town. She never asked her son to do what he did. He just took it upon himself aged 7 or whatever to go out and do it. It took me a while to understand what was happening, but once I did, I can honestly say it was one of the defining events of my life. Not sure if it counts as a shock as much as a slow realization, because I've been going there all my life. But once I got to about 15 and visited Italy, I started getting asked out by guys who just wouldn't take no for an answer. You reject a guy in the UK and they'll normally take it well unless they're a bit unhinged. But in Italy I said no to strangers, friends I'd known for years, people I'd met that night, all people who were otherwise normal who'd be so persistent that I had to either leave or use my cousin as a fake BF. My friend showed me a photo of herself and her mother on holiday in Italy. The two of them are smiling for the camera, oblivious to the crowd of leering men surrounding them. She said she just got used to it. Yep, similar experience when I went to Lithuania with a friend. I'm from Ireland, so I get what you're describing about guys in the UK. When I went to Lithuania though, there was a guy who seemed at least a few years older than me. I was 18 at the time, and I told him I had a boyfriend. I just wanted to relax, was at the beach. He asked things like, "Is the boyfriend here?" When I said no, I got the whole "what happens in Lithuania stays in Lithuania" thing. Dude, just duck off. I am Ty, Michael Gusoff from Argentina and Spain. I eat lunch at 12.30 hours and they are shocked. And the fact that for them lunch is at 16.00 is too crazy for me. Argentina is on a different schedule. I lived in Buenos Aires for couple months. You can hardly find anything open before 10.00. It's a city that wakes up late and stays up late for sure. I ducking love that city though. This is where I was meant to live, I believe. Me too. I've always said that if I had my way, the working schedule would allow me to stay up until 2 and wake up at 10. And it's not just that I like staying up late, I'm actually a happier person on this schedule. I set up a nice candle-lit dinner at home for GF once. In the middle of dinner, she drops that candles remind her of extremely poor family who had to ration their candles into minutes and they had to multitask to conserve light. You had to do your homework all at the same time cause the candles only lasted so long. Still tears me up. Came to NYC and located a good British chippy in Lower Manhattan. Bought sausage, chips and gravy. Would be about 3-4 quid back home. The British guy behind the till managed to keep a straight face as he charged me $20. Did you cry? Or if you're British, I assume you just stiffly paid it, said nothing and seethed in silence. As a Brit, you ducking know that's exactly what he did. You did tut as you walked away though, right? How else will he learn? I tutted at a man once, and he tutted back. I've never been the same. In India, we have a system of printing prices for each and everything on the box packet of that thing. This includes everything from a tiny pack of gums to a giant refrigerator. Vendors cannot charge more than the MRP. They can charge less than that. Most of the big supermarkets and malls usually charge less than the MRP. However, in Europe, I've never seen this. Anyone can charge any price for anything. I've seen a pack of milk can be sold at 4 different prices in my nearby stores. In India, if the owner charges more than the MRP, a consumer can lodge a complaint against them, and they can face serious consequences. Today I learned that I've been charged the absolute maximum for everything when I was studying in Tamil Nadu, India. Always found it weird that vendors would have a check at the MRP before selling it to me, like why would you not know the price? That's pretty normal. TBH. Small shops and vendors hardly make any profit, so they cannot really afford to give you discounts. Supermarkets do that. I grew up in a working class city where passive aggression wasn't a thing. If people didn't like you, they made it obvious. Shouting matches and fist fights were pretty common. Then I get a job at a snooty Ivy League university and nobody expresses what they actually think or feel. Snide remarks replace insults. People quietly conspire against you while pretending to be your friend. And you can't call people out on their bullshit without getting socially shunned because everybody is neck deep swimming in it. I went the opposite way, from college to a union job. It was refreshing when some jackass was late and you heard, "Hey mother ducker, show the duck up on time tomorrow and stop being a piece of shit." This sounds very familiar to what I went through after meeting my husband's family. I come from a large loud Irish Catholic family where everyone knows everything about everyone, and if you have a problem with someone you don't let it stew. You go to them and talk. Fight it out. Funny thing is, my family gets along better than his. There is so much under the surface in his family. They are very waspy and secretive, and I can never keep track of who has beef with who because they are so fake to your face. It makes me feel super uneasy. Recently moved to the US 9 months ago, and I am still not used to everyone asking me how I am doing. I am from Norway, and if the cashier asks how you are, you get embarrassed and don't know how to answer. I was born in Hawaii and lived on the Big Island until I was 6. Little me was used to wearing flip-flops or no shoes, and lightweight dresses, swimsuits and shorts and a t-shirt everywhere. It was too hot for anything else, or it would just get dirty. Cut to my family moving to Ontario, Canada, about 3 hours north of Toronto. My dad was working in the vacation business, so we moved to an actual ski resort for the first few months. My sister and I were enrolled in Catholic school, and suddenly I had to wear clothes. But not just clothes. Stockings, jumpers, shirts with too many buttons and shoes that had to shine, coats, hats, gloves, different shoes to wear outside. 6-year-old me could not comprehend any of this. We even had to change for gym and then change back. My mom helped me put my stockings on in the mornings, but after gym I would have to put them on by myself. One day my teacher called my mom to come get me because I decided to start some sort of anti-clothing revolution and was jumping around the changing room in my underwear with my stockings on my head. TLDR. Moved from the Big Island of Hawaii to Canada at 6 and suddenly had to wear a lot of complicated clothing. Marrying into my wife's Mexican-American Native American family. I come from a small white family. My wife's family is huge. At our wedding I had 15 people attend, which was nearly my entire family. She had 200 people attend, which is only a small fraction of her family. Those that didn't get invited were quite grumpy about not getting invited. When I first met her extended family, I was overwhelmed. There was like 50-60 people at her grandma's house on Christmas. Some of her uncles didn't like how quiet I was being and started telling my wife, girlfriend at the time, how she needed to be careful of the quiet ones, and several of them took me aside to threaten me. Then of course I made a major faux pas. I refused food from her grandma. I've since learned that it would have been better to just slap her in the face. It took me 10 years to undo that damage. I didn't win over her last uncle until I got absolutely tanked at his daughter's wedding reception, at which point he decided I wasn't just a stuffy white guy. Once my wife coached me on her culture, I was able to fit in better, asking for food, allowing the women to serve me and clean up after me, taking plates home when I leave, being more outgoing, etc. Now grandma calls me Mijo and introduces me to everyone as her grandson, which earns her a lot of confused looks. Since her grandma has accepted me, everyone else has too, and according to my in-laws I'm Mexican now. All in all, would do again, but it would have been nice to know that what's rude on the white side of my family is endearing on my Mexican side and vice versa. My parents were the typical Asian kind. Hard to please and difficult to impress. When I graduated class valedictorian for 6th grade, my mother complained that I did not receive any other award like best in science or best in math. When I fell down the ranks of top students, I was still in the top 10 though. My father told me that the reason he stopped attending school events was because he was ashamed of me. When my elder sister got pregnant a couple of months before graduating med school, my mom stopped talking to her for a month. They lived across the hall from each other, unforgiving of failures. That was the kind of parents that we had. When my girlfriend took her licensure exam for accountancy for the first time, she failed the test. I was with her when she told her parents about it. To this day I still remember the shock I felt for what transpired that day. We were seated in her dorm, me beside my girlfriend, and opposite us were her parents. She was finding it difficult to confess, and when the words "I failed" finally came out, the first thing her father said were, "That's okay. Then my girlfriend started crying and her parents consoled her. They were hugging and giving her words of encouragement, assuring her everything will be alright and that the thing to do is to move forward and try again. I just sat there watching them and feeling envious, thinking this is what parents should be doing for their children. It came as a total shock to me. This level of openness and understanding this kind of parent-child relationship was alien to me. I promised myself that if I were to become a father I would be like her parents. I don't hate my parents though. They weren't bad people. They just had ridiculously high expectations of their kids. My siblings and I had a happy childhood for the most part. Sometimes we would sit and talk about how crazy our parents are and laugh a lot. Relating to awards lol. I was always kinda second best at math in school, behind Steve, not real name. Throughout school for years my parents were like, why did Steve do better than you on that test, or Steve got gold on the Olympiad, why didn't you, etc. I got tired of their shit, worked my ass off for the final couple of years to impress them, and when I was awarded the best in math prize they blankly stated, why didn't Steve get it? When I got my first teaching job, I had moved from Nee, Pennsylvania to southern Arizona. I rented a house with my husband and another couple. The house was huge, absolute insanity for what we paid for it. When my students found out I lived in a two-story house, they all were in disbelief. I was told that only rich people lived in two-story houses because no one can afford the AC bill in the summer. In my defense, I was making around 29k a year and paying for a cross-country move. So definitely not rich, but it really put my students' level of poverty smack dab in front of my face. I visited Albania and there wasn't a single chain store or restaurant. That may sound banal, but it was a strange experience to be in a large city and be completely unable to get a McDonald's, Subway, KFC or Starbucks. Similar in Bosnia, although McDonald's opened 5-6 years ago if I recall correctly. It's just that the local fast foods are much better and cheaper. Realizing that in the UK and Northern Europe clubs and bars close at like 2-3 a.m. at the latest, and that being drunk before midnight is normal. Where are you from? That's normal. It's the same here in Canada. I mean, I'm from Spain, so here we go out at 1 a.m. and clubs close at 5-6 a.m. I realize now that it's actually Spanish nightlife, which is a bit over the top wild in that we have a different drinking culture. But imagine my surprise when I went to visit friends a few years ago in the UK and they were getting ready at like 9-10. Which for me was dinner time edit. I'm not saying it's better or worse, so please chill. I had fun going out in other countries. I went to South Korea for a year when I was in the US Army, and they refused to let us tip after a meal at any restaurant. If I recall correctly, some places view tipping as an insult, that you're tipping because you don't think they're earning an adequate living. Which, incidentally, is why they tip in USA. Last year my wife and I took a trip to Japan for 2 weeks. The trip itself went splendidly, and we particularly appreciated how polite things were at all times no matter where we went. Then we flew into O'Hare Airport in Chicago. How New Yorkers can be simultaneously polite and rude, it's fairly impressive. Probably when I was in China and people would either come up to me and ask to take a picture of me, or just straight up starting taking pictures of me right in front of me. I'm 6'2" and a woman, and they thought I must be a model, or a freak. I mean, people think it's odd where I live, but they don't come up to me and go, "You're tall, picture?" One guy stopped taking pictures of animals in the zoo to take pictures of me. I must be on so many Chinese people's social media and family photos. People would come up with their kids and think it was great. Trying to cross the street in Hanoi, Vietnam, you can spot somebody who just got in a mile away because the look of apprehension and confusion on their face as they try to figure out how to do it. There are very few crosswalks with walk signs. In most places you look for a gap in the traffic and go. In Bangkok you just make sure the flow of traffic would have time to stop before they hit you and you just go and maintain a constant pace. In Hanoi, especially near the French Quarter, you just slowly walk into traffic. There are no gaps. You can sort of put your hand out to let people know you're going, but you just kind of maintain a slow, inching, walking pace and traffic will part around you. Scary AF the first time. Every time I come back to Canada from being in Cuba for an extended period of time, the buildings, The cars, the technology, the stores, being able to get whatever you want whenever you want. It's crazy what we've become accustomed to as being normal. Move to Australia from the Philippines. Driving normally between 60-80 kilometers per hour is just impossible to achieve in Manila. Traffic management has been superb, Melbourne, as compared to Manila, so I just laugh inside my head when people here complain about being stuck behind the right light for like 2 minutes or something. Going to LA as a young teenager from a small rural Midwestern town, the size of the city, riding a city bus for the very first time, nobody seeming to care about the ocean. It's just a cold gray blob, I was told. I was definitely a country mouse in the big city. I was raised in an extremely Mormon family with 50 plus cousins living relatively nearby. I attended a Christian private school with a student body of maybe 1,000 students between all grades 1-6. We had to wear button downs and blazers and recite the Pledge of Allegiance every day and read Bible verses in class before lessons. When I was 13, my family moved to Minnesota and I went straight into public middle school where swearing, piercings, racial integration, something I hadn't even recognized I had never experienced, and we didn't have to say the pledge read Bible verses cause the majority of students weren't Christian, let alone Mormons. So yeah, probably that. A few years back, our family went to Japan for a family trip. We were in a restaurant, and my dad tipped our waitress while we were leaving. About 5 minutes after we left, we saw our waitress running down the street. She handed our money back to us. We were all confused, so my dad tried to hand the tip back to her. She wouldn't take the money, and ran back to the restaurant. We didn't realize this, but tipping is considered rude in Japan. Whoa, you made it to the end? You're a ducking beast. I'll cut you a deal. Smash like and subscribe for more curated content, bruh. It's free and that's a great price.